born after the birth of Jesus Christ. So, speaking of Jesus' brothers, the Bible is clear in Matthew 1:24-25 that the angel of the Lord had commanded Joseph and took Mary home as his wife. But the text further says, Joseph had no union with her. The New Living Translation Bible says, he did not have sexual relations with her until she gave birth to a son, and Joseph named him Jesus. We can conclude that based on the text, we can conclude that after the birth of Jesus, Joseph and Mary had lived as ordinary husband and wife. And as we know, an ordinary husband and wife coupled with sexual intimacy and not as ordinary roommates. So their marriage blossomed into true love with Jesus' biological siblings, described in Matthew 13:55-56. Jesus, the name of Jesus' brothers, are described in this text. And one of Jesus' brothers, who is very popular, was James. So in other words, in this portion of the scripture, Jesus draws a contrast between his physical family, meaning the children of Mary and Joseph, and Jesus' spiritual family. We know in the gospel that Jesus was so bent, he was so inclined on mission. He was preoccupied with healing the sick, feeding the hungry, performing miracles, and his claims of Messiah or Savior of the world. And Jesus' claim as Savior of the world was challenged by the religious leaders of the time. The most popular are the scribes and the Pharisees that resulted in heated confrontation with these church leaders. So when the Lord Jesus' family, referring to his biological family, so to speak, heard about the tension between Jesus and religious leaders, to the extent that he was described in the earlier verses, in verse 21, that he was possessed with the prince of demons, and that he is out of his mind. So Jesus' family, his mom or his mother and his brothers, went to take charge of him, according to the text. Went to take charge of him. Probably they wanted Jesus. They wanted to take Jesus in protective custody. Why? To keep the family from shame and embarrassment. That is instinct and family that you want to protect or cover up whatever negative reputation in our family. So it is at this point that Mary, accompanied by her sons, came to the rescue, and probably they were there to take Jesus home. Let's go home. Now, church, I submit three profound spiritual lessons with regard to the true family of Jesus and how we respond in faith as Christ's disciples. Number one, turn off distractions of mind and heart and focus on the Lord. Turn off distraction of mind and heart and focus on the Lord. When you say turn off, what's the immediate response when someone will tell you today, please turn off the liturgy of our church? I have requested Kuyaroy to print that. Turn off your cell phone and switch on your eyes and ears to the Lord. So in a world filled with distractions, the story of Jesus teaching his disciples in the crowd can help us set our lives focused on the Lord. Undoubtedly, Mary had come just like any ordinary mother. He had come with a mother's heart, anxiety about her son's welfare, safety, and security. That's also instinct for a mother. She may have felt that his son was in danger. His son was in danger from the religious leaders who in several occasions or instances have threatened and began looking for a way to kill Jesus. This was part of our text last Friday during our Bible study. They were looking for a way to kill Jesus. So the arrival of Jesus' mother and his brothers had caused a great destruction to those who were listening to Jesus. They were listening to his teaching. Imagine if someone would enter in this church and then out of the blue with destruction. Imagine the overflowing crowd. The Bible describes that there's an overflowing crowd, and there was no other means of communication during the time where they could send their message to Jesus. Unlike today, where it's so easy for us to send a fastest means of communication through text message. In Tagalog, you now, where you are. I'm here now, waiting for you. Now, literally, Jesus' mother and his brothers interrupted his teaching in an attempt to get his attention. So we can also imagine that they started at the back of the crowd and had people pass the message along and then sent someone in to call Jesus. That was the scenario of that day. This act caused a great distraction and interrupted the flow of Jesus' message. And what was the response of Jesus? Probably you would think that Jesus could have excused himself to the crowd and told them, excuse me, my mother and my siblings are there outside waiting for me. So just give me a few minutes. But according to the text, Jesus asked, who are my mother and my brothers? Who are my mother and my brothers? Well, church, this sounds disrespectful. As if Jesus has disowned his very own mother and his very own brothers. But that is not the case. Jesus does not ask questions to exclude his family, but rather, he asks questions to set the stage for expanding the concept of a bigger spiritual family who do the will of the Lord. So, church, in today's world, it's so easy to get distracted. In fact, distractions are the number one cause of most vehicular accidents in the U.S. today. Now, let's take a look at this survey. A recent survey conducted by the survey found that more than four out or in 10 Americans say that they cannot live without their smartphone. Now, let's be honest, who among you here have your smartphone? Please raise your hand. Today, with you. There are some who don't have. I have also my own smartphone. But church, I made it a point that my cell phone is inside my car's glove compartment when the service is in progress. I do not bring smartphone with me inside the temple or inside the church. Last Friday, during our Bible study, our group, or members of our group, admitted that food preparation, panera bread, falls under this category. But the good news is that in our application of the text, the answers or that answers to the question, what changes should I make to my life insofar as distraction is concerned? What changes should I make in my life insofar as distraction is concerned? In a similar way, church, every kind of relationship falls into this category. Parents, siblings, spouses, friends, girlfriend, boyfriend, children, co-workers, and so on and so forth. And we can allow any of these relationships to distract us from God. But if you are faced with a choice between Jesus and our own family, if you have a choice between Jesus and your own physical family, I think I must join Joshua in the Old Testament when he asked, choose for this day whom you will serve. Then Joshua responded, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. So church, followers of Jesus Christ should always choose to serve the Lord. We are commanded to love our family. However, if our family keeps us out of church, that's a problem. If our family diverts us from serving the Lord or focusing on Jesus or hinders us from serving the Lord, there's something wrong with our family. While relationships are extremely important, but church, I believe that our relationship with the Lord is of utmost importance. Number two, the faith community becomes our new family. In verse 34, it says, then Jesus looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, here are my mother and my brothers. Here are my mother and my brothers. I grew up in a big family. The Bautistas, they had five siblings, and the Larrisabals had 10 siblings, Matilda. And my mom was the youngest. And that's another extended family for Normie's family. That's another family. So it's a big, I belong to a big family. But when we follow Jesus Christ, church, everything changes. As we have relationships within the world and have relationships beyond the world, I'm referring to the earthly family and to the spiritual family. So we all have our biological families. We also may have extended families by virtue of marriage. Divorce, married, divorced, married. So that's a lot of extended families. We all have some family members with whom we would gladly spend our time. And while there are those whom we see only out of obligation, we treat them as members of our family out of obligation. A spiritual family, however, is different. When a spiritual family meets, we come together voluntarily. What is the common denomination or denominator between its members as one spiritual family in the world? It's not the DNA. It's not the looks. It's not the brains or economic and spiritual position. But in a spiritual family, church,